You would grab your Bible with me this evening, turn to the book of Daniel. The book of Daniel, chapter 1. Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel. There. It's the first of what is considered the minor prophets, so it's a small one right there after all those long ones. But Daniel chapter number 1, we'll read. We're going to read the whole chapter this evening to give us kind of the full story of the full context of the story, rather, and we're going to look at Daniel's decision, what Daniel decided here, and a very familiar passage, and nothing this evening that I think is going to be revolutionary in our thinking, at least when it comes to this story, but something that I think we'll be able to take and use to press forward for the Lord in the time that remains. So Daniel chapter number 1, we're going to read verse 1 through verse 21, or at least the first 21 verses of the chapter. But nonetheless, Daniel chapter 1, if you would just follow along with me as I read, it says, "In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, into Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord gave Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand, with part of the vessels of the house of God, which he carried into the land of Shinar to the house of his God, and he brought the vessels into the treasure house of his God. And the king spake unto Ashpenaz, the master of his eunuchs, that he should bring certain of the children of Israel and of the king's seed and of the princes, children in whom was no blemish, but was but well favored and skillful in all wisdom and cunning in knowledge and understanding science, and such as had ability in them to stand in the king's place, or palace rather, and whom they might teach the learning and the tongue of the Chaldeans. And the king appointed them a daily provision of the king's meat and of the wine which he drank, so nourishing them 3 years, that at the end thereof they might stand before the king. Now among these were the children of Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, unto whom the prince of the eunuchs gave names, for he gave unto Daniel the name of Belteshazzar, and to Hananiah of Shadrach, and to Mishael of Meshach, and to Azariah of Abednego. But Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. Now God had brought Daniel into favor and tender love with the prince of the eunuchs. And the prince of the eunuchs said unto Daniel, I fear my lord the king, who hath appointed your meat and your drink, for why should he see your faces worse liking than the children which are of your sort? Then shall ye make me endanger my head to the king. Then said Daniel to Melzar, whom the prince of the eunuchs had set over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenances be looked upon before thee, and the countenances of the children that eat of the portion of the king's meat. As thou seest, deal with thy servants. So he consented to them in this matter, and proved them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. Thus Melzar took away the portion of their meat and the wine which they should drink, and gave them pulse. As for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom, and Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams. Now at the end of the days that the king had said he should bring them in, then the prince of the eunuchs brought them in before Nebuchadnezzar. And the king communed with them, and among them all was found none like Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Therefore stood they before the king, and in all matters of wisdom and understanding that the king inquired of them, he found them 10 times better than all the magicians and astrologers that were in his realm. And Daniel continued even until the first year of King Cyrus." As I said, we're going to be looking at the subject of Daniel's decision, what Daniel decided in his heart and his friends decided with him so that they could serve the Lord in a time that would have been definitely not easy to serve the Lord. So let's have a word of prayer, and we'll get into our message this evening. Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this day and this opportunity to meet once again with our church family. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless now this time. I pray that you'd be with me as I preach, and I pray that you'd help Help me to say what you would have me to say. I pray that you guide my thoughts, guide my tongue, Lord, this evening. And I pray that we would learn something this evening to that would maybe strengthen our faith or strengthen our purpose on you, Lord, and that we would continue to do what you've called us to do until you return for us, until you take us home. Lord, I pray that you bless now this time. In Jesus' name, amen. We see just a little bit of a background of this story. In the first couple of verses, we see kind of what's taking place here, how Nebuchadnezzar is coming into Judah. We see that Jehoiakim is the king at this time, and he's coming into Judah and besieging it. And we see in verse number 2 that the Lord gives Jehoiakim into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar. And we see that Nebuchadnezzar has this brilliant idea, which really is not a bad idea at all. He's going to take the best of the best young people of the land. He said, of the king's seed, and we see that, children was no blemish. They were well-favored, skillful in all wisdom, cunning in knowledge, understanding science. They had the ability to stand in the king's palace, and so on. So he's saying, find the best of the best and bring them back to Babylon, back to the land of the Chaldeans, and we will teach them the way of the Chaldeans. We'll teach them how to take them from being Jews to being Chaldeans. We're going to train them how to be Chaldeans so that we can further our reign, further our empire, and make ourselves better. And really, that's not a terrible idea if you look at it just if you take out of the fact that they were God's chosen people, and you take all that and you just look at it and say, okay, that kind of makes sense. You want the best of the best that can serve the king, and they can be the people who, when people look at your empire, they say, wow, those are some good people. And so we see that among these were Daniel and his three friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And we see that they were taken captive, carried away from what they knew, carried away from their families, carried away from many of them probably had their families killed. And we see that they were taken back out of Judah into Babylon, into the land of the Chaldeans, into this taken from the land of God, so to speak, to this pagan country, this pagan nation, to worship false gods. And we see all these things take place, but we notice something here about these four men, that they decided that even though they were young, even though they were away from everything that would have kept them doing what they were supposed to do, all those outside pressures that say, hey, you're supposed to do this, all of the things that would have kept them doing that, even though they were away from that, they still decided that they were going to keep their testimony and serve their God. I think it would be very hard for us if we put ourselves in that situation, taken away from everything that we know, taken from our country, from our families, from everything that we hold, and taken away from that and put in a situation like these men were put in, I think it would be very hard for us to keep the same testimony that they did. But we see that they found favor with the king. We see they found favor with the prince of the eunuchs. The name Belteshazzar, given to Daniel, literally means the king's prince. He was someone who found favor with the king and found favor with, as we saw, the prince of the eunuchs, and even the one who the prince of the eunuchs put over them. So they were someone who every time someone came and talked to them, or someone who was interacting with them, they found favor with him. And what a wonderful testimony that they had. But we see four things about them. We see three things kind of that they did, and then a result of it that I think is very important for us living thousands of years later in a completely different land than these men were. But I think it's still very important for us to take these things and try to apply them in our lives so that we can go forward for God and so that we can have a testimony of doing what God would have us to do. We see a couple things. First, we see that they purposed. They purposed. In the verse number 8 of the chapter we just read, it says, but Daniel purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself with the portion of the king's meat, nor with the wine which he drank. Therefore, he requested of the prince of the eunuchs that he might not defile himself. A very familiar verse, but something that is incredibly important for us to realize even today, that if we're going to do something for God, if we're going to live a Christian life, if we're going to read God's word, if we're going to have a daily prayer life, if we're going to be faithful to church, if we're going to be a faithful witness for God, we must purpose to do it. The things of God, as we've heard, I know Brother Deckler said it, I know Pastor said it, the things of God do not clamor for our attention. The things of God are not pulling us every which way, saying, no, you need to be reading your Bible. Oh, you need to be going to church. You need to be a soul winner. You need to do all these things. It doesn't work that way. God doesn't clamor for our attention. He talks to us through, as we see from Elijah, he talks to us through a still small voice in the Holy Spirit. And he's talking to us that way. And if we're going to do anything for God, if we're going to go forward for him in any way, if it's in our personal devotions, if it's as a witness, whatever the case may be, if we're going to do anything for God, we must purpose to do it. It's not going to happen by accident. No one ever became a giant of the faith, so to speak, by just waking up one day and accidentally getting into the will of God. We must purpose to do what we're supposed to do. I believe there are many things that God wants us to purpose in our heart to do. I believe he wants us to purpose to have a daily walk with him in Bible reading and prayer. We can see that throughout Scripture. I believe that he wants us to purpose to be a witness for him. We see that in Mark 16:15, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I believe that he wants us to purpose to be faithful to church. Hebrews 10:25, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another and so much the more as you see the day approaching. I think there's many things that God wants us to say, you know, I'm going to have a purpose to read my Bible. I'm going to purpose in my heart that I'm going to draw as close to God as I can. I'm going to have a purpose to pray to God on a daily basis. I have things that I need to ask God for, and he wants to hear from me. So what better way than by praying to him and asking him for those things? I'm going to purpose to be in church. I'm going to purpose to give of my time, talent, treasures to the Lord and do whatever he would have me do. I'm going to purpose to be a witness for him, to go out into the highways and hedges and compel them to come to Christ. I believe that we need to purpose. We need to do what God has called us to do, and we need to realize of the things that we find in his word, what he does want us to do. We need to look on, and once we purpose to have that daily walk with him, then find those other things that he wants us to do and purpose to do them in our lives. We see first they purposed. We see not only that, we see they practiced. Not only did Daniel purpose in his heart that he wasn't going to defile himself, we see a couple verses down. He says, prove my servants, I beseech thee, 10 days, and let them give us pulse to eat and water to drink. Then let our countenances be looked upon before thee and the countenances of the children that eat the portion of the king's meat. And as thou seest, deal with thy servants. We see not only did they say, hey, this is what God wants us to do. They knew they were purposed to do this because they knew God's commandments, but they practiced. Hey, God wants us to do this, so we're going to do what we need to do. We're going to need to talk to the people we need to talk to. We're going to do whatever we need to do to make sure that we can stand up and do what's right. So he goes to him and says, prove thy servants, I beseech thee, 10 days. He came up with an idea. He didn't say, okay, well, I know we're supposed to eat this for 3 years, and I'm not going to eat it for 3 years. Just whatever, you know, I'm not going to do that. I'm going to just drink this water, and whatever happens, happens. No, he went to him, and he said, hey, how about give us 10 days, and you can see what happens. What does he say at the end? As thou seest, deal with thy servants. He's making he had a very diplomatic approach, but he still determined, he purposed in his heart that he was going to practice in what God had told him to do. He knew what God's commandments were. He knew of the love that God had for them, but the law that God had given them. And so he said, I need to do this. I've determined in my heart, I've purposed in my heart that this is what I'm going to do. So, hey, Prince of the Eunuchs, can you work with me so that I can do this? And I think that's a very important thing for us to realize, that it's not enough to just say we're going to do something. It's not enough for us to say, you know what, I'm going to read my Bible. And then when the alarm goes off, hit snooze a couple times, and then you don't have time to read your Bible. It's not enough for us to say, you know what, I'm going to go out soul winning, and then every time you have an opportunity, we just pass on it and say, well, I'll do it next week. It's not enough for us to say, oh, I'm going to be faithful to church, and then when Sunday evening rolls around, we find something better to do. Right? It's not enough for us to just say we're going to do something. We must start to do it. It's not enough for us to say, I think God wants me to do this. We must put it into practice what God has told us to do. So we see not only did they purpose, they practiced. Not only did they practice, they persevered. Notice verse number 14 and verse 15. It says, so he consented to them in this matter and proved them 10 days. And at the end of 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. I want you, I know the Bible doesn't give us this detailed of these 10 days, but I want you to imagine these four guys are, I imagine them in a big cafeteria, but I'm sure it was different than that. I just imagine them sitting there with those metal tables, you know, that fold down with the benches like when you're in school. But I imagine all these guys sitting there and they're all eating this meat and drinking this wine, and they're living it up, right? The Bible doesn't say exactly how many were brought, but I'm sure there was a lot of them, because we know when they returned from the captivity in Nehemiah, Ezra, you can read through all those things and see some captivity things going on there, and there's a lot of people there, right? So we see there's a lot of guys here, and you got these four guys who are eating just pulse and water, right? They're just eating their vegetables and drinking their water, and we see that I imagine that they're like, come on, guys. There's no one here. The priests aren't here. Our parents aren't here. There's no one making you do this. You have an opportunity to eat this meat that we're not supposed to eat, or drink this wine, which we're not supposed to drink. But you have this. There's no one here that's going to know. And I imagine that the first day, they're like, no, we're just going to leave us alone. We're going to eat our pulse, drink our water. And I imagine it just kept getting worse and worse. You get to the seventh day, and they're like, what, you guys think you're just better than us? Is that why you're eating, drinking the water and eating the pulse? You think that you're better than us because we decided we're going to eat the meat and drink the wine? So that's what it is. You're just better than us, and you think you know better, and you think, oh, you're more holy than we are. You can think of a lot of examples in your mind, I'm sure, but notice, they stuck with it. They didn't say, oh, they didn't get to day seven and say, you know what? You're right. This is just too difficult. It's too hard to put up with all the grief we're getting from our fellow Jews and all of this that's going on. And the king, if the king catches word that the prince of the eunuchs let this happen, they're going to be in trouble. And you know, we'll just kind of fall in line and do what we're supposed to do. And a lot of Christians, unfortunately, that's what happens. We say, you know what, God wants me to do, fill in the blank. And so we start doing, in those first couple of days, it's like, cool, look at this. Look what I'm doing for God. I'm going forward. I'm reading my Bible. I've read my Bible 3 days in a row now, and I'm getting something from it. I'm learning. I've been in church. I haven't missed a service in 3 weeks, and we're all excited about it. But then something happens. Something gets tough. Maybe the crowd's saying, what, you think you're better than us? You think you're better than me? Someone maybe at work, you invite them to church, and they say, "What? Oh, you think you're more spirit? You're better than me because you're religious, right?" And we say, "Well, no. I mean, I'm not." And we get our feelings hurt, or something happens in our lives, and we kind of fall off a little bit. Maybe we're not reading our Bible quite as much. Maybe we say, "Well, I don't necessarily need to go to the Wednesday night service. I mean, I don't have to tell everyone about Christ. I don't have to give an invitation or a tract to everyone I meet. I mean, the Bible doesn't say I have to tell everyone, right?" But we purpose and we start practicing, but then we don't persevere. The link between starting something and succeeding at something is perseverance. The key to starting a race and crossing the finish line is perseverance. That whole section in between in the marathon, from step one to 26.2 miles, that marker, that space in between there is perseverance. Even if it's just a sprint, if it's just a 100-meter dash from that first step to that 100-meter mark, it's perseverance. And the same is true with our Christian life. If we're going to start something for God, the difference between someone who takes a step and falls off to the side and the person who takes a step and just keeps going and crosses the finish line, the difference is perseverance. And we must not be, we must be strong, and we must be willing to do what we're supposed to do for the long haul. We must be willing to stick with it. The work of the Lord and the life of a Christian is, I believe it's something that's worthy of some dedication. I believe it's worthy of us saying, you know what, it might get hard, it might get difficult, but God wants me to do this, and I started this knowing God wanted me to do it, and I'm going to keep doing it because this is what God wants me to do. I think it's very important for us to persevere. We need to be strong, and we need to stand up for the Lord, and we need to do what we're supposed to do, even when things get tough, even when people turn against us, even when our friends forsake us. We need to be persevering in the work of the Lord and in the life in our life as a Christian. We see they purposed, we see they practiced, we see they persevered, and we see because of that they prospered. They knew what God wanted them to do. They knew the law of God. From Moses, they knew the love that God had for them because they were his chosen people. And because they stayed true to what he had commanded them, God let them prosper. Notice in verse number 15, we see that they, the end of 10 days, their countenances appeared fairer and fatter in flesh than all the children which did eat the portion of the king's meat. We see that's just the physical thing right there. That's just the 10-day mark. But jump down to verse 17. It says, "And for these four children, God gave them knowledge and skill in all learning and wisdom. And Daniel had understanding in all visions and dreams." We see that they had knowledge, they had wisdom, they were skilled in learning. And Daniel, the leader of the group, the one who stood up and said, "I'm purposing in my heart, I'm not going to defile myself." He even was granted understanding in visions and dreams. And we see how that helps him in the next couple chapters. But we see that they were given many things. See, this was just a physical thing, right? This was a physical law. You're not allowed to eat the meat. You're not allowed to drink the wine. And so they said, "We're not going to do that." I don't think they thought that it was something that was going to bless them upon blessings, as we see. But we do see that they were given the physical blessing of, hey, because you obeyed God's law, you're fair and fatter in flesh, you did what you were supposed to do, and God rewarded you for that. But then he went even farther and said, and because you obeyed what I told you to do, you obeyed that small commandment. It doesn't say anything about all the other men that were there, all the other young men who were there who were training to stand in the king's palace. It doesn't say anything about them, but what does it say about these four men? That they were given knowledge and skill and all learning and wisdom. That Daniel received understanding and visions and dreams. And we see that standing for the Lord blesses us in ways that we don't even think it's going to bless us. Right? These men probably thought, they may have thought in their mind, hey, if we do this, God might bless us for taking a stand for him. It might be that we, just drinking water and pulse, are going to be better off than everyone else. How cool would that be if we drink water and they're drinking wine and we eat these vegetables and they're eating meat, but we're the ones who are more fit and more in shape. How awesome would that be? Right? I imagine these guys had that conversation maybe with themselves, but I don't think any of them thought, if we don't drink the wine and don't eat the meat, I don't think any of them thought God's going to make us more wise. Right? God has a way of taking our small steps of obedience to him and blessing us beyond anything we would ever think. You know, the Bible says that he's going to give us above that which we ask or think, and I think this is a wonderful example of that. But notice, if we want to be prosperous as a Christian, we must follow what God has commanded us to do. Joshua 1:8, we quoted it this morning in Sunday school, but it says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." Notice God tells us, I've given you things that you need to do. And notice, we talked about those when we were talking about purposing to do those things that God would have us to do. He says, you need to be in my word. You need to read my word. You need to pray and have daily communion with me. You need to be a witness for me. You need to be faithful to church. You need to be willing to give of yourself to the service of the Lord and the service of others. And if you do those things, then thou shalt make thy way prosperous. If you observe to do all that is written therein, if you read God's word and put everything that is written in there into practice, then thou shalt make thy way prosperous. We see that Daniel and his three friends here decided. They purposed in their heart that they weren't going to defile themselves. And then they practiced what they said they were going to do. They persevered in it and kept going, even when it may have gotten difficult, even when people might have said, "You guys are crazy." They just kept doing it. And because of that, God let them prosper. God let them be pillars of this nation. We see Daniel serving under multiple kings and being really a right-hand man to many of them, and being the one who, when no one else could figure it out, when the magicians and astrologers are like, "There's no way we can figure this out," Daniel comes in and says, "But there is a God." Right? And we see him over and over coming to the rescue, so to speak, of this nation that he didn't even belong to, he wasn't born into, but it was where God had him to serve. And we see that even under this difficult circumstance, as we said, he was carried into captivity, a difficult time here. He purposed to serve the Lord, and he decided he was going to do what he was supposed to do, and he stuck with it, and God let him prosper because of it. Daniel and his friends were willing to commit their lives to the Lord, willing to do what they were supposed to do. They were willing to stick with it and stay true to what God had told them. No matter what came into their lives, no matter what happened, they stuck with what they were supposed to do. And because of it, God let them prosper. God let them be successful. God let them stand true. And we see in a couple chapters, because of the stand they took here, that Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah are thrown into the fiery furnace, but they come out once again. And we see Daniel thrown into the lion's den and coming out once again. And all of this happened because why? Because they were willing to stand for what was right. They said, God wants me to do this. God has told me to do this, and I've purposed in my heart that this is what I'm going to do. I've purposed that I'm going to do this. I've started on this path by faith in the Lord, and I'm not going to turn back from it. I'm going to stay on this path until God tells me a different direction to go. I'm going to persevere in this because I know that if I do what God has told me to do, that's where prosperity comes from. That's where being successful as a Christian comes from. Sticking true to what God has told us to do. So this evening, let's determine to purpose in our heart the things that God wants us to do. Let's look at God's word and see what are some of the things that God wants me specifically to do. We talked about the broad ones already, reading God's word and praying and coming to church and being a witness. We talked about those things. But what are the things that God wants you specifically to do in your life? Once you find the purpose to do them, and don't just say, hey, I'm going to do this, then start doing it. Start practicing it in your life. Start getting to it and then say, no matter what comes into my life, until God tells me to do something different, I'm going to persevere in it. Because when we do that, that's how we prosper. I think each and every one of us want to be a successful Christian. I think we want to be a prosperous Christian. I think we want to be someone who, when our Christian brothers and sisters look at us, they say, oh, he's a prosperous Christian. I'm not talking about wealth or all of those things, but someone who is a pillar of Christianity. I think we all want that. And I believe this is the recipe for it. I believe this is the recipe for us to be determined to do what God has called us to do, to put it into practice and start doing it, and then no matter what comes into our life, be willing to persevere through it. As we said, the link between starting and succeeding is perseverance. Stick with it, and then God will let us prosper, just like he let Daniel and his friends prosper. And we must realize it might not necessarily be here on earth. We might not have all the fame and all the things that come with being prosperous here on earth, but when we get to heaven and God looks at us and says, well done, thou good and faithful servant, I think that's going to be all the prosperity we need. I think that's going to be all the success we'll ever need when God says, basically looks at us and says, hey, thank you for what you did on earth. I'm proud of the work that you did for me. I think that's going to be everything we're going to need. So realize that we must do these things. We must purpose, we must practice, and we must persevere if we're going to be prosperous as Christians. Let's take a page out of Daniel's playbook. Let's take a page from this decision that he made, this decision to serve the Lord and go forward for him so that we can be prosperous in our Christian life.